Hello, welcome to this Jaguar XK8 video about CD changer, no disc error. This is video 127 in our series of XK8 videos. And in this video, we're going to go through our attempt at fixing the issue with the CD multi-changer. You see here, well, actually, we've got to put the multi-changer in, please, the cartridge in first. We've already taken it apart. I'll show you how to take it all apart and check for various things. So this is what we were getting. Absolute refusal to play any disc whatsoever. And on the readout on the head unit, you get a no disc error. You can see the disc changer going through all the discs. Completely refusing to do anything. And if we go back to the head unit, you have this lovely error, no disc. But actually, we have got discs in there. So we're going to show you how we attempted to fix it, partially anyway. We're going to do this in our usual format in several sections. So section one, removing the actual CD multi-changer itself. Section two, a bit of a diagnosis. Section three, some maintenance on it. Section 4, refitting it all back together, and section 5, the result, did it work? The tools we use in this video are very simple as always. We used a ratchet and a couple of sockets, 6mm and 10mm, a cross screwdriver, and for the maintenance, a bit of grease. Ideally, you want to use white grease, but we just used some aerosol grease. If you're interested in Jaguar XK8 cars, please take a look at our channel, O&DR Modurol. Lots of content about the car there. Okay, first of all, section one, removing the CD multi-changer. So the changer is actually located in the luggage compartment, in the boot. You need to remove the battery cover. It's very easy to remove that. Just pull that out, put that to one side. This is needed to come out to actually facilitate removing this trim now. So to remove the side trim, you can see the multi-changer in there. You need to pull at the rear piece of the carpet, get it out of the way of the lamp holder. There's no clips holding this in position, it's purely fitted in, and it pulls out, as simple as that. So that's the trim, and that should reveal then the multi-changer and its bracketry. Very easy to get access to it. There are two ways of removing the charger. You can actually remove these small screws on the top and the side. There you go, those four bolts, as I say. And that will actually pull the whole unit out and some sub-brackets. Or you can pull the whole bracketry out altogether by taking these two bolts out of the side. So there is a further third bolt on that metal tab at the back, but in my case that wasn't fitted. So there you go, two methods of taking it out. You can't actually take the CD changer off its bracket because the screws, even though they are present, there's no hole through holes in the metal bracket to get at them. So you either have to use one of the methods I've already described. You either take the sub bracket out or take the whole bracketry out in one lump. So as I say, the fixing points, there's four on the top. They're all 7mm AF bolts. They're actually flange screws FS10 5121J. And there are captive nuts in the metal metal bracket underneath, and that's JJK10511. To actually remove the whole bracket itself, those are actually 10mm AF bolts, and there's two, possibly three. If you got the third one at the back, that's particularly difficult to get at, so it may not always be possible. In my case, that third one in the back wasn't fitted. It was just as easy to take the whole lot out. So I remove the right-hand bolt with my ratchet, remove the left-hand bolt, taking the socket, the CD changer socket out of the way, and removed it. It was easy as that. And it's quite fortuitous to do that, so you can check for any rust down the back. This is where you have an issue with rust along the back of the wing above the bumper. It rusts from the inside out, and you can see quite clearly the stud at the back there I've circled. In my case, I've already treated the rust once, but there is some signs of it coming back. So I took the opportunity, it's only really rust staining to be honest, but I took the opportunity to stick some more rust preventative fluid in there. I'll make a separate video about these sort of fluids and paints I've been using to try and keep the rust at bay. Prevention is that these cars are always trying to rust away, and it's just a matter of managing the rust. You can't really stop it. It's about managing it and making it slow it down, really. So that's the subject of another video. So once we've got the bracket out, you can see those screws quite clearly captive. So even though you got the whole unit out, you still can't get the CD changer out from its bracket. You've got to take those four bolts off as well. 1, 2, 3, 4. Need to take those off to get at it. So we'll do that now. You take your 7mm socket and quickly undo them with my screwdriver attachment to my socket. It's a very useful piece of kit, that. It's probably, I was thinking about all the favourite tools I have in my toolbox, and that screwdriver attachment for my sockets is probably my favourite piece. It turns every socket into sort of a screwdriver style. And for these sort of bolts, they're not very, very tight. It's very easy to undo them. Ratchet is probably a bit of an overkill. Can see you can very quickly take the bolts out. Last one, number 4, and we should be able to take a CD multi-changer out from its main bracket housing. Last one out, there you go. Oh, it's all part of the company. So now you can see the CD changer is bolted in with, or it's just screwed in with two more screws each side. So get your cross screwdriver and just literally undo those. Again, they're not particularly tight. Just prop it up so you can see it a little bit better. If you want to mess about with your CD multi-changer yourself, this is all really easy stuff, basic tools. It's more awkward to do it in front of camera than anything else. It's very easy to whip out the multi-changer, take a look at it, do whatever maintenance you see fit, and try it again. Also, I think these multi-changers are all made in Japan, so the reason they're high quality, it's just the age of them gets the better of them, I think, and they start to fail and you get that no disc error. Neither, so I think the two brackets that are fitted are actually there isn't a left and a right hand, it's the same bracket, just fitted at different sides. There's a anti-rotation washer behind the screws to stop it rattling free. So there you go, the CD changer is completely out and free of its brackets. Now we've got to look at trying to undo it now to get the lid off. If you're interested, there are a couple of different types of CD auto changers or multi-changer, up to model year 1999, and including model year 1999, you have, which basically the same multi-changer, but it has a different socket. It has this 8-pin socket, as is seen on the left-hand side. From model year 2000 onwards, it's got a bit more intricate looking socket. It's not pins, it's sort of little bit more complicated design of socket. So you've got to make sure, if you do buy another multi-changer or replacement one, make sure you get the right part number. The early ones are LXF4160CA, and the later ones were LXF4160C onwards. If you're after cartridges, the cartridges for these multi-changers are all identical, albeit they're different part numbers, LNC4161AA or C2514 40 three, but they're basically all the same. They work the same way. If you're interested in knowing more about your stereo, I've done a more detailed video 74 called Which Stereo Audio System, and it goes all through the base OEM premium bands. It gives you all the part numbers and the various options you could expect to find. Section two then, diagnosis, my attempt to try and diagnose what's happening. So in order to do that, we opened up the multi-changer case. There's basically two screws on each side, very small ones. Be careful not to lose them, they are very, very small. When I take all the screws out, I normally put them in a plastic tub, which is out of sight, stop them firing across the garage, and it's me spending half an hour trying to find a screw, which actually probably takes longer to do that than actually to make the video. Such is life. Who hasn't been there? Okay, there's two screws on each side, and there's actually three of these gold or zinc coated screws on the left hand side. Sorry, they're probably not, they're not zinc, they're cadmium plated, sorry. And you've got to take those three out. They come out very easily. I'm not quite sure what these are supposed to do, because when you look inside the case, they are practically no use whatsoever, other than hold it, the case on, in which case you don't need three. So that's almost there. Just got the final two screws to come off the back. All these black screws are all the same type. I'm not sure of the part number because it's part of the CD itself and I don't have it listed. So hopefully the lid should just now lift off. You have to slide it back slightly and it pulls away and you get access to the internal workings of your CD multi-changer. There you go. So now we're going to have a little play with that. First I did a test, actually, as you saw originally in the video, the first video, of trying to play the CDs and observing what they're doing. Every time I tested this, it did something slightly more. You can see now that the CDs are actually trying to play, albeit extremely high speed, and then they sort of trip out and go back in. So it starts up at reasonable speed and gets faster and faster. You can almost hear, like you'd normally hear on a computer, the CD sort of spinning up very, very fast. Normally when these CDs are playing in the CD auto changer, they're going reasonably slowly. Now in this case, I think this one does actually start to play. You can see the speed of that, it's a lot slower. So I'm going to have to... Yeah, I think this is playing. But I think I've left the volume down in the car, so I can't tell. So I'm going to have to go and have a look. Go and turn the volume up. Give me a second, let's go and have a look. It's definitely trying. Can you hear anything? No, come on, let's go and have a look. I've probably got the volume turned out. Oh, okay. So there is some sign of life then. So it is playing. So that's with little or no work at all. Let's try and force it onto the next disc. It didn't like the first three. The first two. Again, it's going very high speed. You saw when I first tested it, the disc would go in and out and not attempt to play. Now, after a few minutes of messing around, the discs are attempting to spin up. Oh, that one that one failed altogether. Yeah. It likes that one. It likes Billy Idol for some reason. Yeah, that one's playing. So, there's some signs of life. It's obviously worth pursuing. What I did do, I investigated the disc. So, was there anything particularly wrong with the discs in the multi-changer? I took a look at them and actually tried to clean some of them up. Very rough. There was no major scratches on them. The odd bit, give a bit of a wipe. I know it's very rough, but there wasn't anything fundamentally wrong with the CDs, or nothing different that I could spot. I actually did try and move the Billy Idol CD, the CD that was playing, to a different position in the multi-changer, just to see if it was a CD related or a magazine related thing rather than a mechanism. See, I think that's trying. It's trying its best. It's trying. No, it doesn't like that one. No. So we got we're back to complete failure. No, it doesn't like it at all. Try again. No, it's not having it. So at that point, I think, well, it's obviously working. There's nothing wrong with the reading head. It does play a CD, albeit it's very intermittent. So let's try and do a bit of maintenance on it. So section 3 maintenance. I say, so take the lid off. I was showing you before. And we actually then tried to actually remove these dampers to access the bottom of the multi-changer, because there isn't a lot of mechanism at the top you can see, but it's all at the bottom. So what I did is basically pulled the little dampers off, the suspension dampers that hopefully stop your CD skipping as you hit a bump in the road. They simply pull off. So there's two of those each side, and there's a spring in the middle. So basically a spring and damper set up each side. There is adjustment for the CD auto changer at various degrees, but obviously it's set at horizontal, normally in XK8. So I took the dampers off and then just released the spring by moving it to the right. And it just releases straight off. There's one at the other side as well. The whole mechanism is suspended within the case. You should be able to lift it. There's a small ribbon attached at the other end. I didn't attempt to remove that. But all of a sudden you've got access to more of the mechanism underneath. Let's show you that. There you go. That's the mechanism underneath. Just have had a quick look at the rubber mechanism, the suspension dampers, just rubber mouldings. Nothing particularly special. As I said, just dampers. Just dampers. And very easy to pull on and off. So I took made an attempt to actually lubricate the mechanism. So there's several cogs on the front and sliding pieces of mechanism. That's on the top. I say we've got access to the bottom now. So at the bottom there's several more. This is the cartridge up-down mechanism, and there you got the sort of the feed for the CD reader and its rails. There you go, the top rail there. And there's also a mechanism at the bottom here which feeds the CD in and out of the cartridge. So I thought, well, might just give a go at using a bit of the grease to lubricate them. What was interesting, before I did that, I actually made sure the reading lens was clean. Now you can't actually see it from the top, because it's obscured by the bracketry, but you can move this the head over to a hole so you can see the lens, and get a cotton bud and wipe it with some cleaning fluid. As I say, I've moved it over there, and there's some cutouts in the top now, and I can move it to a certain angle. You can see the lens of the CD lens there. It looked clean enough on mine. I'd actually took a bit of white spirit and cleaned it up. Sorry, methylated spirit, not white spirit. Cleaned that off with a cotton bud. So there's nothing wrong with the reading head itself. Then I got some grease. I would have preferred white grease, but I didn't have any. I had this sort of aerosol grease, and I've greased all the rails up for the head to move backwards and forwards in case it was that. And all these cogs, I gave a little bit of a squirt of grease, making sure everything was lubricated. It's very difficult to get in there. Oh, spilling everywhere. So I greased the feed. Just move the mechanism backwards and forwards to make sure it the grease gets everywhere. So moving it over where I've actually put the grease there. So I was pretty sure the head would be moving. Okay. I mean, I'm not an electronics expert, so I'm just doing basic maintenance, greasing everything up, because it seemed to function. It was just maybe positioning, maybe there's a bit of wear somewhere, or you can see a lot of the remnants of white grease everywhere that's actually dried out. So my theory was that the whole mechanism had basically dried out over 20 years and just needed a bit more grease everywhere. So I greased everything up the best I could, nothing electronically repaired, and then I reassembled the springs and the dampers. Now this is quite tricky to do because you've got to sort of keep hold of the spring, which does fall off very, very easily, and then push it back in position once you've caught the spring. So you've got to hook it up on this mounting hook and then grab the back of the other end of the spring and put that piece in position. Now there is a wide hole at the one end, you poke it through and then you move it to the right to the correct position. It will go there. It's obviously a bit tricky because it's under the pressure of the spring. Now I did the side with the ribbon on first, because obviously it's more, you get more access. To fit in the dampers, I applied a small bit of light oil just to help with the lubrication, to help them slide back on again. Without that, it's extremely difficult to put them back on. Literally, you've just got to sort of squeeze them back onto the spigot of the on the mechanism, suspended mechanism, and it's very difficult because it just pushes the damper back all the time. It took me two or three attempts to get this right, off to a fine art. I see it's depressed all the damper again. Just flick it all out and try again. And eventually you do get the hang of it. I say using light oil or a bit of lubrication is definitely the way to go. Without that, you're really wasting your time. So get it in there, just push it on, a little bit of a rotation, and hopefully we're there. No. Believe me, I did get this right in the end. Let me try again. So it's the same when you're trying to demonstrate something, it never quite works as you like. It's a bit tricky. There you go. Have we got it this time? They either go on straight away or they don't go on at all. There you go. We're away. We're away. So do that. Do that on all four. Assembly of the side, I say, it's basically the same. Make sure you do the side with the ribbon first, otherwise you're not able to pull it up like this to get the other side on. There you go. Keep hold of it. It's very, very difficult. I'm not going to show anymore because it's just embarrassing. Putting the lid back on is very easy. Just put it over the top and just get it into that recess in the front cover and refix all the screws. That is it's relatively easy. It's just reverse of what we did originally. I'm not going to show you fitting all the screws because it's very, very straightforward. So you fit the gold ones back in, then the two at the back. Try not to lose the screws. And then the two at each side. Those two. Make sure you've got the two at the back, three on the side, and the two on the other side. All fitted and ready to test again. So refitting the actual unit into the housing is very, very simple. You need to put the bracket over, positioned over the rear stud. As I had it, there wasn't actually a nut on mine originally because I think somebody had been taking it in out a previous owner. But I got my box of nuts and washers and I thought I'll find myself a nut to put back in its place to make sure it's all fastened securely. There you go, 10mm AF nut. And then applied that on the back position and made sure it's all tight. You know, before I actually put the whole thing back, I needed to reattach these brackets. As I said, they're not handed. They need to go with the hole to the left here. You can see the actual witness of where the screws had been, so it's not particularly difficult. Those screws, the little black screws, are SE10-40-84J, if you're interested. So fit those, and then you basically need to reconnect the charger cable. Push that together. Very difficult to do one-handed. Put that, and then refit the assembly. As I said, this should just slide in, much as we pulled it out. Tricky, and get it in position so you can see the captive nuts. There you go, each side, and then it's easy just to reapply the bolts. It's probably harder to put the side bolts in than anything else. These flange screws are FS105121Js, and the captive nuts on the brackets are JJK10511. You can say the side holes are the trickiest to get in. Particularly one-handed. So all the screws are in, all you need to do is just tighten them all up and it's away to go. There you go, the four screws ready to be tightened. Now it's natural just to stick the connector in that gap, but that's not where it's supposed to be. There is actually a clip on the side, which I'm trying to show you here, but very difficult. There's actually a clip on the side of the bracket for that to sit in. You can see that. You need to put it back in there and save it rattling around and causing problems later. So finally, how for section 5, how well did it actually work? Well, let's put the cartridge back in, complete with Billy Idol, and give it a go. If you're not familiar with these CD changer cartridges, this little button, when depressed, should eject your cartridge. It should spit it out like that. If it doesn't do that, you've got more problems. So, right, so that hopefully is loaded. Let's take a look at whether it's working or not. There you go. Disc 1. No disc. Oh dear, oh dear, dear, dear. Disc 2. No disc. Disc 3, no disc. We're not having a lot of luck here. Disc 4, ooh, is it going to do something? It's obviously spinning up. No, no, come on, please do something. No, disc 4 did have a try. Disc 5. Oh, it's playing. So we got some success. So one out of the six is playing. Let's try another one. Let's try six. Now what I found after playing with it, the more you play with the multi-changer, the more it likes to work. So I'm hoping that the longer I play around with the CD and multi-changer and get it working, the more it's going to accept the actual discs, so that grease is going to work. Oh, so you got disc one is working now all of a sudden, so it's three out of the six working. Disc two, no discs. Disc two, try again. So we got 1, 5, and 6 at the minute. Oh, disc two is working. This is how crazy it is. So 1 minute it was working, next minute it isn't. Disc three, no discs. Disc three, give that a whirl, give it another chance. Might work second time. No disc, no. And so really the answer, or the overall summary, is it will help lubricate in your multi-changer, but it's not going to fix the problem altogether. So partially successful, partial failure. So there you go. So there you go, the video, removing the diagnostic, testing, maintenance, refitting, and did it work? Well, partially. And to be honest, I'm probably going to give up with a CD auto changer anyway and go for something Bluetooth, which I'll follow in an I'll cover in another video. Thank you very much for watching. If you like these videos, please take a look at our channel. Thanks again. Please give a thumbs up if you liked it, and please like, comment, share, and subscribe if you'd like to see more XK8 videos.